Welcome to Sergeant War Dog TV.
All I know is war. All I know is shoot. All I want is more. But I got some things to do. I'm a dog of war. Hell's what I've been through. I'm a dog of war. I did it all for you. I'm a soldier, I'm a warrior. Got a emblem on my cover. And ask me what I did for ya. I put the trash deep down under. Yeah, I'm a dog of war. Hell's what I've been through. I'm a dog of war. I did it all for you, yeah.
Welcome to the War Dog Trail. This is episode 13. Before this episode, I know everything that I do and put out has been amateur. There's no question about that. I haven't in any way ever told you that I was anything other than a Marine grunt. But I did want to reach out to war veterans in any way possible. To let them know they aren't alone, to help with the suicide prevention, and to put the word out about Camp Doghouse that we are building to house homeless veterans here in Central Florida. That said, I will let you know that everything you see or hear, whether it's from this podcast, from the web series Sergeant War Dog TV, from social media, from images I create, everything on my own, run everything on my own. And I do this all based on my health situations at that particular day or moment. Time. So, because my health is so unpredictable, I cannot at this time provide you with a specific date or time that podcast episodes or webisodes will be produced or created. And most of that is because of the fact that, as I've mentioned, with most other war veterans, the physical and mental pains that we experience can all fall on you at the drop of a hat. They can come on you at any time, especially unexpectedly. So everything revolving the War Dog Trail, Sergeant War Dog TV, and any other plans I try to make in my life are all contingent upon my health at the time, which currently I've been battling another horrible bout of tinnitus. Both of my eardrums were burst, blown from my 3 tours in Iraq. So these past 6 days have been hell on earth for me. A straight nonstop ringing. I mean, ringing loud enough that I can't even hear what other people are saying to me when they speak. That obviously it leads to, because of your ears and your eardrums are so close to your brain. Those pains automatically lead to horrible and debilitating migraines as well. This episode, we're going to continue in part 3 of the discussion of tinnitus, dealing with it. And for the first time, since I'm now trying to professionalize this podcast as much as possible, we will have broadcasts longer than the usual 15 minutes. And I'm going to begin to introduce Sergeant's playlist to you. And if I haven't said it before, the Sergeant's playlist is simply my selection of new and unheard of artists from all genres that I come across on YouTube, YouTube Music, Spotify, SoundCloud, you name it. If I hear it and I can vibe to it and it coincides with my either podcast content or outdoor TV content, I receive personal permission from each artist to feature their music, and then I use it to collab and try to put out, you know, something for the war veterans, man. Discussing tinnitus again, or tinnitus, and from what my audiologists at the VA have told me, we can use either form of the word, or it's tinnitus or tinnitus. I've already in the last two episodes told you how badly the pain can get, how debilitating. Gone over some of the methods or some of the events during the Iraq War that caused my eardrums to be blown, whether that was planes or Cobra helicopters, or being around the tanks, or being around artillery when they need to fire danger close within several hundred yards of our position to get the enemy off of us, or to help you survive a firefight. And let me mention, man, the longest firefight that I was ever in lasted 14 hours. Just outside of Fallujah back in 2004, a city called Al-Karma. And that gunfight and that firefight lasted from 2 in the morning was when we got on site and began to take contact and whatnot until 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Let's see. We've already gone over the fact that tinnitus has no cure. So the best that you can hope for is to use coping techniques such as masking in order to help you endure the pain, to alleviate some of the pain and suffering that come with it. I mentioned in the last episode times when we had to have, you know, doors blown off, knocked off, so that we could make entry into buildings, houses, what have you. And making those dynamic entries, most of the time, my hearing problems, times when I know for a fact I completely went stone deaf, usually came when we needed to get into a place, to get into a building. And obviously the door might have been locked, so we either, you know, attached the line charge, attached some C4 at the door and blew it, and then, you know, continued on with our dynamic entry to meet the enemy and engage the enemy. Or during times when guys might use their rifles or 12-gauge shotguns to come and shoot the hinges off the door so that we can make entry. Now, besides those entries that I knew gave me a lot of ear damage because they, my ears rung so loud that eventually they reached a peak and I just couldn't hear a damn thing for a while. I mean, I could see the other Marines speaking to me. I could see their lips moving and all, but I was standing there yelling, "What?" you know, over and over, because I had no idea what the hell they were saying. Another major incident that I know led to my own eardrum damage took place during the first tour in Iraq. Shortly after we crossed the border, maybe within the first week of the war, I remember rolling into some town where we noticed that all the weapons in the city, you know, majority of the ammo, the guns, the mortars, majority of the weapons cache happened to be in schools. And going by the Geneva Convention and some of the laws of warfare, we generally try not to attack or blow up, you know, certain key facilities within the community. Obviously, you had the mosques, so that we could respect religion. And then there were also schools, hospitals, that sort of thing. So that, you know, you minimize as much damage as possible to facilities that are needed to cater to the populace. Went into a school once. Saw, you know, AKs and RPGs everywhere within that school, which they knew we weren't allowed to or supposed to attack. But usually the way that works is, or at least for us in the Marine Infantry, if you start to take fire from any of those places, hospitals, from schools, we were then authorized, you know, to meet that threat head on. And if that meant blowing the building and every motherfucker in it, whether it was a school or anything else, then that's what had to happen. So going through the school and clearing, and in the infantry field, man, room clearing and urban ops is just one aspect of what you do. And I primarily had a big thing on the, I've always been a big fan of SWAT techniques. So, going through that school, you know, blowing doors, making entry, button hooking, crossing, you know, we're searching every bathroom, closet, hallway, door. And I want to point out that might be one of the biggest differences, in my opinion, between what I've known and seen SWAT teams in the U.S. to do, where they might hit one house, one or two houses, and then, you know, capture or engage whoever their mission required them to deal with. And then after that one house, man, they're done. That's it. But during a war, you don't just hit one house when you're a grunt, man, when you're in the infantry. You're going after every house in the whole damn city, the whole neighborhood. If you think about any building or home you've been into, think about all the places that a person could hide. A person could already have a gun waiting for you to walk in so that they could take you out. I can't describe the amount of pressure and readiness that you need to have at all times to constantly be going and searching for these people in bedrooms, bathrooms, every closet, every office, every backyard. If it's a two-story building, you know, you're clearing each floor. There are times when we crossed the border when I was a bit confused during my first tour. When I look over to my left or right, while, you know, the rest of my entire company of Marines was raiding these cities, villages, searching, like I said, not just one building or house, but every single house there, every room. I'd look over, see SUVs. Primarily right now, I'm remembering there were a lot of Mitsubishi Montero SUVs. And usually that's where you'd have special ops guys. At times I've seen, you know, team of SEALs would wait behind us in SUVs. Other times you might see ODA guys from the Army, Special Forces guys. For a long time, it confused me why they weren't out there with us going house to house. And that was until I, you know, later became to understand the concept of direct action and low-intensity conflicts, where similar to a police officer or deputy sheriff that patrols, you know, a local zone or region, you might go through the same neighborhood, walk past the same houses day by day, and not know that someone else is watching that house as a target, watching the individuals in that house as a target. So I've been on few ops where, say, we as Marines might wait on the perimeter of a city, or wait, you know, on the street that a particular target house is on. And then specifically, I remember one op in 2004 where SEAL Team 7 came in by Hilo. We were out surrounding the city. I was freezing my balls off in the middle of the cold desert at 2 or 3 in the morning. You know, scanning with my night vision goggles. Other guys scanning with their thermals. But their only specific mission, only direct action task, was to fly in, hit one particular house, gather any individuals or intel that they were told to get. And these are places that some of these guys might have been like IED or bomb makers. If you remember the deck of cards that was out during the beginning of the Iraq War, if you remember, there's a deck of cards that was made of all the top personnel in the Iraqi military that we needed to, or that we wanted to find and capture or acquire. A lot of those direct action missions involve things of that nature. You know, whether it was, something as large as the Jessica Lynch rescue and recovery, where I think it was a team of Delta Force operators that went in and got her out. And like I said, you know, they come in smaller teams, but each, don't get mistaken at all, each person within that team, male or female, is usually qualified to do several jobs, man. They all have, not just one set skill. Each person there can do everything from being a sniper to a medic to a driver to being able to speak a foreign language and interpret for you. Each person within these teams, they're all highly trained and have been through some of the toughest schools in the world. So they're all multi-talented. They all have many skills, man. But that was my first introduction to the SWAT way of doing things, where, you know, a specific house, target house is hit, and then you leave. Or, like I said, with the direct action missions of the military, seeing the special ops guys behind us as the infantry, or not even coming in at all, because we were there specifically during the day with the enemy knowing when we were coming. We were specifically there to raid and find and kill and eliminate every single enemy within that city, village, or town. And that meant we hit every single building, room, bathroom, doorway, as opposed to the other, like I said, special ops guys or recon marines or force recon marines coming in and striking one or two houses and then leaving. Take that, the SWAT and special ops missions on as far as approaching target house or target location versus the conventional warfare method of what an infantryman has to do. And there's just no comparison. It's really no comparison. But before we take our first break here, and I'll let you hear the first song from the Sergeant's playlist with our first artist, I'll just end that story telling you, we searched that school, we found tons of ammo, bomb making materials, guns, obviously bullets within that school. So we cleared all of our guys out. We set up demo explosives on the building, on that, on those munitions and weapons. And on a specific day that I'm referring to, during the first week of the war, I know for a fact that I suffered a lot of hearing damage and probably even a concussion after we performed a controlled detonation of that school. You know, we all took cover, crouched down somewhere, waited for the building to blow, waited a minute or two, got the all clear, and then, you know, we came from our concealed positions and proceeded on, began to walk past the building, walk past that school. And out of nowhere, man, the building blew again from secondary explosions, you know, from the munitions that were inside. I mean, our control deck blew, you know, what it could blow, and then certain things catch on fire and whatnot. As we were walking past the school, the fucking building blew again. And I'm talking, you know, flying glass. Obviously, it was loud as hell. It blew my ears again that time. Pretty much rung all our bells, but not enough to the point that we, you know, ended up being unconscious. And even if it was, man, you gotta remember, this is the first week of the war, so if you weren't dead, man, or severely wounded, you did everything you could to keep up with your team, with your squad as a Marine, and continue to fight, man, because at that time, everything was hot. Everything. There were no bases left at that time. There were no places to go and get, you know, hot showers or to use the internet, that sort of thing. Because we were the first ones in. First ones in across the border. First ones in all the way to get to the capital to get to Baghdad. This time, no further ado, I want to introduce to you an artist by the name of Caleb Daniels. Young 17, 18-year-old kid out of Michigan. I want to say Saginaw, Michigan. This first song by him is titled Get the Bag. And this is your introduction to the Sergeant's Playlist. Salute.
Hey, wake up in the morning, get the bag. Stay up till the morning, they familiar with the bag. And that's the price you pay when you be trying to get the bag. I put on for my city, bitch, I do it for the sake. Hey, wake up in the morning, get the bag. Stay up till the morning, they familiar with the bag. And that's the price you pay when you be trying to get the bag. I put on for my city, bitch, I do it for the sake. And I gotta get the bag, that's a bare necessity. I'm cooking up the sauce, bitch, I got the recipe. And I treat this like a race, no one gets ahead of me. machine. And I'll do this till I die, put that shit on everything. And I pull up on the scene, and this ain't what it seems. Trying to differentiate with what I want and what I need. And I ain't trying to wake up from this $1 million dream. Need a $1 million deal, got a $1 million team. Need a $1 million check so I can spend it all on me. I've been working like a maniac, I'm putting in some weeks. I've been putting in some years, and I don't fuck with fear. And I'm about to speed it up, like I'm switching gears. And I'm doing what I want, I don't listen to my peers. Made the shit I wanna make, not the shit they wanna hear. And all I see is hope when I look up in the mirror. Cause I see a young goat, tell the bag I'm getting near, I'm on the way. Wake up in the morning, get the bag. Stay up till the morning, ain't familiar with the bag. And that's the price you pay when you be trying to get the bag. I put on for my city, bitch, I do it for the sake. Hey, wake up in the morning, get the bag. Stay up till the morning, ain't familiar with the bag. And that's the price you pay when you be trying to get the bag. I put on for my city, bitch, I do it for the sake. I'm the everywhere kid, I'm everywhere now. And my family and my homies, yeah, that's all I care about. If she hit me up and ask me all about my whereabouts, that's another thing that she probably shouldn't worry about. But I'm probably in the booth, and I'm just getting loose. We about to warm it up, but you know we keep it cool. And I've been learning everything I wish I learned in school. That's the reason why I'm fucking running, breaking every rule. And this'll make them duck, so put it on the tape. If I ain't doing this, then I'm making a mistake. If I'm pursuing this, we gon' take it out the state. And I keep it A1, bitch, we raising up the stakes. What you think? Wake up in the morning, get the bag. Stay up till the morning, ain't familiar with the bag. And that's the price you pay when you be trying to get the bag. I put on for my city, bitch, I do it for the sake. Hey, wake up in the morning, get the bag. Stay up till the morning, ain't familiar with the bag. And that's the price you pay when you be trying to get the bag. I put on for my city, bitch, I do it for the sake. Hey.
All right, that was Caleb Daniels out of Michigan with the song Get the Bag. Caleb's originally from Kentucky. And he's probably the youngest artist I have on the Sergeant's playlist. You can find him on Instagram at I Am Caleb Daniels or on Twitter at I Am Caleb Daniels. Let's see, continuing with the issue of tinnitus. We've gone over some of the remedies, to include the hearing aids that play white noise for masking that loud and painful ringing from your blown eardrums or perforated or burst eardrums. Some people find relief using just simple cotton balls, depending on their level of ringing, the volume of their ringing. That doesn't work for me. Before I was given my hearing aids 7 years ago, I was first given a mold, an ear mold, that fits the inside of your ear canal, and it blocks any wind or loud sounds from attacking your eardrum. And those worked for me for a while until the ringing became a daily issue that I had to deal with. I mean, it went from once every blue moon to every day. And then the volume of that damn ringing went from simple low-level ringing, you know, which is manageable. I mean, don't get me wrong. When I tell you this is debilitating, and that, yeah, even after, as an infantry marine, as a sergeant, going to Iraq 3 times, all of that shit, when it gets to those certain debilitating levels, those levels that truly make your ears hurt, that can cause any other sounds, or I'm sorry, any other sounds can trigger that ringing and that pain. I had to go towards hearing aids that did have the tinnitus sound generators built in to play white noise for me all day to provide some form of relief, because I was going fucking crazy, man. And it's just my personal opinion here, but I think that just one small factor in veteran suicide, and you know, so much of what we've been hearing about with veteran suicide, I really think a large proportion might revert to seeing suicide as their only option, because there is no cure and the ringing never stops and it is painful as fuck. It's hard, like I said, to make any plans, man, for your life, for your day, when the slightest noise that is either too loud or that has too high of a pitch can set your eardrums off so that they are nonstop, constantly ringing and causing you pain for, man, up to 2 to 3 weeks straight. And when that shit becomes unbearable, I have to admit that even I have had times where I wanted to just blow my own goddamn head off, because the ringing and the pain and the inability to stop that shit is just too much to bear. And so, like I said, that's what I feel is one reason. Just one reason. Why so many veterans? Might succumb to suicide or see that as their only option of a form of relief. Like I said, I used to try things like dunking my head into a sink full of water and, you know, just staying there and covering my nose and, you know, trying to clear your eardrums as much as possible, trying to clear those ear canals, you know, trying to make your ears pop in the right way. And usually, personally, each time I do that, each time I, you know, cover my nose and blow in order to help the ears or ear pains, I can always hear little, you know, little popping or bubbling or releases of little sound and pressure. And sometimes that's all it takes to help with the pain. But then there are those other days, man, where the shit's so loud, so intense, so painful that the only thing I can do is go to the Brainwave Tuner app or the White Noise app and just listen to those sounds for hours or for days and just wait out the pain, man. You have to wait until your body, your ears decide to stop hurting you, man. Until they can diminish to a level that's somewhat bearable. We've all seen, or most, you know, most of us have seen those comparisons, those sound decibel comparisons, where you know, they might compare the loudness of an airplane engine to the loudness of a concert, to the loudness of being in an NFL stadium or a college football stadium. But 9 times out of 10, man, the loudest and first choice on those comparison charts are usually gunshots. They are by far usually the loudest and most painful. And when you're an infantry marine, that just becomes, you know, part of the job. I mean, whether you're dealing with firing your own weapons to the sound of mortars dropping near you, car bombs, buildings blowing, C4 for blowing off doors, using 12 gauges to shoot the hinges off doors, any of those loud sounds, man, that you're dealing with and you're hearing day by day, especially danger close, man. If you're in the shit, you're in a lot, you're a heavy firefight with the enemy, you need a plane or tank or artillery round or even a Cobra helicopter to come around, along with a Hellfire missile. The closer you are to needing that ordnance dropped for your survival, the higher the likelihood of you having to deal with the concussive forces that come from those blasts. And specifically, besides, you know, possible concussions or waves that can, the force waves, the sound waves that can come across you. Damage to your ears, man. Damage to your eardrums is a major after effect of being a frontline infantry guy. These past three episodes in which I've discussed tinnitus and ear pains are all obviously mean a lot to me because I suffer from it on a day-to-day basis. But even more so, I put them all out there so that any and every war veteran can know that they are not alone in dealing with this issue. They're not alone in this type of suffering. They are not alone in feeling that sometimes suicide is the only option. Or might be, or, you know, they, if they feel that's the best option. I'm never saying that that's right. But obviously with the volume of veteran suicides that we have in our country and with military veterans around the world, man. Or war veterans around the world. Dealing with that debilitating condition in and of itself can be a major factor that most people, most civilians can't relate to, don't understand. They might feel they understand on a certain level because they work in fields that are around loud noise, but nothing will compare to those guys who work with guns, who fire machine guns on, you know, thousands of rounds for a living. Because remember, with those comparison shots, comparison charts, few things are as loud and damaging as gunshots. And for me, using that M249, man, able to fire hundreds of rounds a minute, especially with barrel change, or the M240, or any of the weapon systems the military has that can fire automatically. You're not just dealing with one shot and then one painful ring. You're dealing with thousands of shots and thousands of times of each of your eardrums, you know, having to take and deal with those loud concussive sound waves damaging the eardrums. That's basically in a nutshell what these past three episodes have been about. Because I do know it is a major factor. I do know that even I personally, my first 3 years in the Iraq War was not issued earplugs during a war. Because the guys in the infantry, we need to be able to hear each other. We need to be able to speak, move. And I'm not just talking, you know, having a radio, using throat mics, having headsets with earpieces. you need to be able to hear your team leader tell you to shift right or to go from firing at this particular building or target or group of people to now this other area, depending on your mission or operations that are going on. I'm going to close out this episode with another fire track from the Sergeant's playlist. This one also involves the artist Caleb Daniels. Caleb is out of Michigan, originally from Kentucky. This next song is titled Listen to You. And you can find Caleb, as I said, on Instagram at I Am Caleb Daniels or Twitter at I Am Caleb Daniels. Salute.
Tonight, I wanna talk about the things that's on your mind. I wanna listen to you. Wanna listen to you. Yeah, yeah. We gon' ride tonight. I wanna talk about the things that's on your mind. I wanna listen to you. Wanna listen. Too much time trying to work on yourself when you ain't even broken. That shit not good for your health. Say you got all these problems and you expect me to help, but how am I supposed to solve them when they solving themselves? But I'ma listen, and I told you that to all of your problems that you don't even have. Baby, it's so perfect just the way you are, so I don't wanna hear about your faded scars. Yeah, we'll go night riding, we can play this while we talk about how your day went. If there's anything you gotta vent about, I'ma pay attention, I'm patient, that's real. And baby, if you try to tell me how you really feel, then we gon' ride for real. We gon' ride tonight. I wanna talk about the things that's on your mind. I wanna listen to you. Wanna listen to you. Yeah, yeah. We gon' ride tonight. I wanna talk about the things that's on your mind. I wanna listen to you. Wanna listen to you. Yeah, yeah. And this what I need. I spend days in the studio, sometimes don't even sleep. They say the top is a lonely place, I guess I'ma see. But when I get there, I know that I'ma miss your company. I hope you don't let it rain when I call you just to talk it out. I'll always care about you, please don't block me out. Cause when I'm on the road, just know I'll still have time to listen from a distance, yeah, we still gon' ride. Yeah. We gon' ride tonight. I wanna talk about the things that's on your mind. I wanna listen to you. Wanna listen to you. Yeah, yeah. We gon' ride tonight. I wanna talk about the things that's on your mind. I wanna listen to you. Wanna listen to you.
Alright, that will conclude episode 13 of the War Dog Trail. Be sure to check out SergeantWarDogTV.com. where we have a link for the Sergeant's playlist. You can see all of our artists. And be sure to check us out on all social media platforms, especially YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, Snapchat, and TikTok. Salute.